It's Tuesday, 2 days before the Passover and the second day after Yeshua of Nazareth had ridden into the sacred city of Jerusalem on a donkey, and the whole city, to the frustration of and in defiance of the leadership of the nation, the whole city had erupted in uproarious, excited, wild welcome of him as their long-awaited Messiah and King. But as exciting as that day was, yesterday was even more breathtakingly sensational. Yesterday, this Jesus had seized control of the temple. He had driven off the merchandisers and the swindlers. He had cleared out that den of thieves, and he had assumed the measure of mastery over those sacred precincts, which the Hebrew scriptures made the prerogative only of Messiah himself. Such a day. But if yesterday was even more spectacular than Sunday, who can imagine what today, Tuesday, might hold? Welcome to session number 7 in our study of the Passion Week of Jesus. It's Tuesday now, and so we are going to focus on Tuesday then. Now, we have been using an outline of the week that we'll stay with. Here it is on the screen. And again, Sunday, a day of messianic presentation. That's the triumphal entry, as we say. But now we come to these 2 days, Monday and Tuesday, which I'm calling messianic proclamation, days of messianic proclamation. And I'll explain that more carefully as I go. But suffice it to say at this point, that remember that we are dealing with a question that arises out of our consideration of the events of the triumphal entry. And that question quite simply is, given Sunday, why Friday? Given the fact that on Sunday, the city explodes in happy welcome and seems for all the world to be not only willing but eager to embrace Jesus as their king, why on Friday is the same city crying out, crucify him? We'll not have this man to reign over us. And so that's where we're headed, and we just got started in a little bit yesterday. But we're going to pursue it today. And I think by the time we're done, I trust that there will be at least a plausible answer that I can suggest to you, given Sunday, why Friday? Now, we are going to focus on the events of Tuesday. Of course, that's our focus for today. But I want to take you, in anticipation of that, to a verse here in Luke chapter 20. Now, this is just one verse in the midst of his telling of the Tuesday narrative, but it just perfectly characterizes these 2 days. And so just as sort of almost a title over these 2 days, I'm going to make this slightly bigger. Let me give you these two verses here that I've marked in purple, where Luke says, and again, this is after a parable where Jesus had really scolded, if you don't mind, the leadership of the Jews, and the chief priests and the scribes that very hour sought to lay hands on him. Now, that's twice important. First of all, you have this phrase, chief priests and scribes. And the point is that those are the Sadducees and the scribes are the Pharisees, and they don't get along. They hate each other. They can't agree on anything except for this. Jesus has to get dead. And that's what they're after. But at any rate, they sought to lay hands on him, but they feared the people in this tension, for they knew he had spoken this parable against them. But then look at verse 20. So they watched him. And they sent spies who pretended to be righteous in order that they might seize on his words in order to deliver him to the power and the authority of the governor. That's these 2 days and every way. As a matter of fact, if I could characterize these 2 days, and especially Tuesday, with one word, and if you could put that word in a bright color and have little lightning flashes all about it and perhaps bold and underlined, that word would be tension. Stunning, palpable tension in every way. And just to make that point, I want to go through the synoptic record very, very quickly. And I have each of the synoptics up here and the narrative of Tuesday. And I've highlighted some phrases, some clauses, some sentences, and so on, just to try and pick up on the tension. And specifically, in purple, I have highlighted what seems to me to be a representation, a characterization of the attitude of the leaders. And then in green, I have highlighted the attitude of the people. And just now, we're going to go back through this rather quickly, but as a preliminary, just to set the stage, I thought it might be healthy just to work through these. So here we are on Tuesday, and in Matthew chapter 21, this is his, as a matter of fact, in the earlier passage, he has told us about the cleansing of the temple, and that happened on Monday. So this is Matthew's telling of Tuesday. And he says, and I just want that phrase in purple, when he came into the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people confronted him as he was teaching. So he's at the scene. Jesus returns from Bethany back into the city early on Tuesday morning. He goes up to the Temple Mount, and the crowds are following him, and they materialize immediately, and he begins to teach. But the chief priests come and confront him. But in the midst of this narrative, they acknowledge that they have to be careful because we fear the multitude. Well, let me go a little further. That tension between the angry Pharisees and the fascinated crowds. A little later in the same passage, now when the chief priests heard his parables, the chief priests and Pharisees, they perceived that he was speaking of them. But listen to this. When they sought to lay hands on him, they feared the multitudes because the multitudes took Jesus for a prophet. Hear the tension there again, very quickly now. Here again in a later event, it says the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle him in his talk. So here, what Matthew is saying, the Pharisees caucused. They went and put their heads together. So what are we going to do? We got to get rid of this guy. We got to catch him in his words. And they sent to him their disciples with the Herodians. I got an idea. Let's try this. So again, and looking down here, when they heard these words, this is the tax question, and Jesus answers so cleverly, so magisterially, that it says here in verse 22, when they, that is the leaders themselves who had hatched this plot, when they heard Jesus' words, they marveled, and they left him and went their way. You hear the frustration? They're working so hard. And then the same day, the Sadducees came and asked him and so on. But when the multitude heard Jesus' defense of the resurrection, the multitude, they were astonished at his teaching. And then finally, when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, again, they gathered together and they sent a lawyer. I love this story. We'll come to it in just a bit. But the fact is, you hear that same thing. They are desperate to somehow put a stop to this Jesus Express, to somehow derail what Jesus is trying to do. And then again, the Pharisees are gathered together. But you hear this, when Jesus argued his messiahship, no one was able to answer him a word, nor from that day on did they dare ask him a question. So again, and then Jesus breaks into these withering woes upon the Pharisees. Now, you hear something, I think, of the dramatic tension between the anger of the Pharisees and the fascination of the people. Let me just, I'm perhaps overdoing it, but let me do the same thing in Mark just quickly. And he does the same thing as he begins his Tuesday narrative. I've moved to Mark now. They came again to Jerusalem. This is Tuesday morning, coming from Bethany. As he was walking in the temple, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders, listen to that, the chief priests, the Sadducees, the scribes, basically the Pharisees, they hate one another. The elders, other of the Sanhedrinists, came to him and challenged him. But again, we're reminded they feared the people. Here, after the parable of the vineyard, they sought to lay hands on him, but they feared the multitude. They knew he had spoken this parable against them, so he left them and went away. Then they sent to him some of the Pharisees and Herodians. Again, I'm trying to really emphasize this reality. This is not ad hoc. This is not kind of every man for himself. All of Jesus' enemies, as deeply as they hate and resent one another, in every other course of life, they have joined forces and they are putting their heads together and they're doing everything they can to somehow put a stop to this. But they marveled at him the way he handled himself. All right. Well, we've seen this before. No one dared ask him any questions, but the common people heard him gladly. And I could go on. Well, I will. I'll take the time real quickly because Luke emphasizes some things. Now, again, here's the cleansing of the temple, and here is Luke's beginning, the beginning of Luke's Tuesday narrative. It happened on one of those days as he taught the people in the temple and preached the gospel. So the gospel is, I am your Messiah. I am here to offer you myself as Messiah. But the chief priests and the scribes, together with the elders, confronted him and so on. So we've seen this before. We read this passage just a minute ago. They could not catch him in his words in the presence of the people. Now, this is Luke, and that's what's going on. They're trying to catch him in his words, but they marveled at his answer and kept silent. These are the leaders. Again, I'm going to say, can you imagine? Can you feel? Can you sense the frustration? And again, one more time, some of the scribes answered, "Teacher, you've spoken well." After that, they dared not question anybody. And then in the hearing of all the people, he began to say, "Beware of the scribes." So again, one word that I would use to describe the mood, the spirit, is tension. And in that regard, let me just take a moment and let's just, I want you to get in the moment. It's so important to do everything you can to just wrap yourselves in these narratives and get in the moment. And if you do that, it seems to me it's interesting to consider what's going on in the minds and hearts of various players. So first of all, let's just settle it. We've already seen it. The leaders of the nation, anger, frustration, well reflected in the verses we've read. Anger, they are beside themselves. Now, they've been mad already. Again, they put a price on Jesus' head some weeks ago after the Lazarus episode, and then Jesus had ridden boldly into town. He hadn't sneaked into town. He'd ridden into town, and the city welcomed him as king. If that wasn't enough, the next morning he came back and laid claim to the temple. So they're mad beyond words, and throughout the course of this day, that anger just metastasizes more and more until by the end of this day, the Jewish leaders, both Pharisees and Sadducees, are quite frankly a bit unhinged. They're mad with their hatred. All right, those are the leaders. What about the common people? Again, greater and greater fascination, admiration. Remember, that's not explicit in these texts, but during this week, Jesus has been doing miracles of healing and so on. So the common man is ever more excited. And now again, in the face of that, with the fascination, the admiration, there's a great deal of confusion. You remember that some of these people were local and perhaps had heard a lot about Jesus and talked about him. Others are coming from various parts of the world and they've just barely heard. So there's a lot of confusion, but there is universal admiration on the part of the common man. What about the apostles? Well, if there's one word that I would use to describe the state of the apostles, if you don't mind, it would be the word deceived. They were delighted, but they were deceived. Some months ago, Jesus had told them explicitly he was going to die. They had been unable and unwilling, some combination of those two, to receive it. They didn't want to hear it. Just a few days ago, when Jesus was making his way up from Jericho with the disciples and with the crowd, he had told them a parable because they were convinced that the kingdom would soon appear. Beyond that, that's in Luke 19. Beyond that, you remember that they were absolutely convinced. I was going to say that in Luke 18, I lost my thought. In Luke 18, 31 to 34, Jesus had on that same trip, just before telling that parable, he had taken them aside, his disciples, and told them once again he was going to die. And in verse 34 of Luke 18, Luke says that they didn't get it. They couldn't understand it. So on the one hand, they were delighted because who'd have thought? Yeah, I keep saying, 7 months ago, Jesus had begun talking about dying, and they don't want to hear that. But good heavens, Sunday we rode into town, the whole city welcomed him. Yesterday, Jesus took control of the temple and gave us perhaps quarters of the temple to watch over to make sure nobody was carrying any vessels of water, if you don't mind. But the point is that if you're one of the apostles, you're thinking, I don't know what the dying talk is, but this is a good thing. We are on a roll, and it's only going to get better in that regard. So I'm going to say again, the leaders, anger. The people, fascination, admiration. The disciples, delight, but they're deceived. And then I'm going to ask one other question. What about one other apostle? One that is not other, but one of the apostles, and that is Judas. I want us to think about this because it's going to play itself out in the events of this day, Tuesday. But Judas is an unbeliever. Now, he's not an unbeliever because Jesus had not sufficiently made a case for his messiahship. He's not an unbeliever because he hadn't seen enough miracles or done enough miracles. He's an unbeliever, and by that I mean he has refused to give his allegiance to King Jesus. That's what belief is in the Bible. It's allegiance. It's submitting yourself to obey and to trust one who demands he rule in your life. That's what biblical faith is. And Judas was an unbeliever simply because he loved his sin more than he loved what he knew to be the truth. He knew it to be the truth as much as any man who ever lived. And yet, as John tells us, as the Spirit of God gives us this remarkable insight in John chapter 11, Judas was a thief, and he loved his sin more than he loved what he knew to be the truth. And you know, here's a very important spiritual reality, if you don't mind my wandering for just a second. Sin makes you stupid. It really does. It just makes you stupid. Not necessarily in the sense you're not very smart, but it makes you stupid in that everything gets distorted and perverted and contorted and twisted. And that which ought to delight you becomes a heaviness to your soul. And that which ought to disgust you, you somehow have an attraction for. And your reactions all. And so here the point is, Judas is more and more the victim. I don't want to say victim. He is self-enslaved. And so I think it's fair to say that Judas is doing a slow burn. He's angry. He resents all the excitement. Now, he's a good imposter, and he's going to keep the act up until Thursday night. But Judas is angry, and he's going to get more angry. Now, we're going to talk about this tomorrow. We're going to meet on Wednesday, but we're going to talk about the feast that happened last Saturday night and the rebuke at that feast and how it settled in, Jesus' quiet, blessed rebuke. That nobody else was stung by, Judas was stung by. But why? Because sin makes you stupid. We'll talk more about that. But Judas is more and more angry and resentful. All right, well, I want to turn to the events of this third day of the Passover cycle. And to make that point, I'd like to go to, here's a list. This is just a list I put together. These are the basic events. Now, before we get to them, I want to handle one other sort of backdrop issue. But this is what we're headed for. This is what we have before us. On this day, Jesus comes into the city. And for most of the day, he teaches there in the temple. And we have recorded some of his teaching, and specifically three remarkable parables. But those parables are sort of intertwined with three deliberate challenges on the part of Jesus' enemies. So Jesus is teaching, but he's being interrupted by various ones of his enemies, and they have questions that they have dreamed up very carefully, hoping to take him in his word. Now, after that, catch him in his word. After that, there is a sort of a standalone challenge by a young student of the law. I have lawyer here, but it means a student of the law, and we'll talk about that. It's kind of a delightful counterpoint to what we've seen up to that point. And then late in the afternoon, Jesus pronounces a series of withering woes upon, that is, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees. And that really is kind of the high point of the day, the centerpiece of the day in terms of what we are trying to do, trace the narrative and answer the question given Sunday, why Friday? And I need just to set you up for that. But then after that, there is a remarkable lament over the city of Jerusalem. And then you have this as Jesus leaves the city late in the day and makes his way back to the east over the Mount of Olives. His disciples comment on the beauty of the stones and the buildings of the temple. And Jesus preaches what we remember as the Olivet Discourse late on Tuesday. And then that night, Tuesday night, after they have returned and probably pretty much settling in for the night, Judas steals off and makes his way to the home, the personal villa of Caiaphas, the high priest, the great villain in this entire story. And there on late Tuesday night, Judas breaks a logjam, and he makes a deal that he will help the Sanhedrinists arrest Jesus. Now, we're going to talk about that primarily tomorrow. But let me take you back to Tuesday, and I'd like to just pick up the, we'll just make our way. I'll go to the scriptures, and we will make our way through the events of this day. And I listed them before, and let me just say that the Gospel of Matthew gives us the full account. Only Matthew gives us all of these interchanges. So let me take you here in Matthew chapter 20. No, I don't think I'm where I want to be. I want to be here. Matthew, there's my problem. So here I am in Matthew chapter 21 in verse 23. And again, I think for some people's folks, for some, the sake of some of you, it might be good to make this just slightly larger if you're sitting across, if you're looking at a screen, but here it is. So now again, I'm going to walk you through this rather quickly. And I'm going to work hard to communicate the something of the tension that is absolutely in, you know, just the ambiance, the miasma that has settled in upon this scene is one of unspeakable tension. And by the way, I haven't mentioned, remember, that is true with regard to Jesus as well, because he knows what these people are planning. He knows what is afoot, and he has to handle himself so carefully. But let me just begin here with, first of all, so it's Tuesday morning. I say again, Jesus has returned to the temple. He had, oh, by the way, I don't have this in the notes, but along the way, he had discovered the fig tree that he had cursed the day before. So we talked about this at some length yesterday. It was cursed on Monday morning, and on Tuesday morning, the disciples were amazed because it had so immediately, so quickly, so much more quickly than anybody could imagine. It was withered from the roots up. So we talked about that, but as he came into town, then once again, following that same route, and that route, by the way, from Bethany, would take him through as he was coming up the backside of the Mount of Olives, just a half a mile from Bethany, perhaps, is Bethphage. And Bethphage means the house of figs. And so it clearly was an area where a lot of figs were grown, but he had had that two-day adventure, first of all, on Monday, cursing the tree, and then on Tuesday, finding it cursed. But now he comes into the temple, and he begins to preach. And again, I'll read it to you. The chief priests and the elders of the people confronted him, saying, and by the way, if we go to Matthew, I can drop it down here. I'm sorry, to Mark. Where am I? I'm in Matthew. Oh, if I go to Mark, it says the chief priests, I got to keep it here, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. So Mark gives us, Peter and his telling in Mark, gives us this little insight that not only the chief priests and the elders, but also the scribes. And I'm going to say again, these two groups, the scribes being the Pharisees, basically the chief priests, the sages, they don't get along. They hate each other. They fight each other. They resist whatever the one wants, the other one doesn't, except at this season. They're so anxious to be rid of Jesus. Now, I'm just going to tell you the story. They come and they say, by what authority are you doing these things? Who gave you this authority? Now, please hear me. This is more than simple pique. These are not simply the Sadducees, who do, in fact, exercise rule over the temple precinct. But this, they're not just saying, hey, who do you think you are? Well, this is ours. There might be some of that, but that's not what's at stake here. Because they're trying to catch him in his words. Remember what we saw in Luke? In order that they might take him to the governor. Now understand, and Jesus is so wise here. And so he says, he realizes that the real question, the real intent is, they are hoping that Jesus will say, I am your Messiah. And as Messiah, I have every claim to the temple. Amen and amen. What they want to hear him say out loud in simple language is, I am Messiah, because Messiah means king. And we'll talk about this on Thursday, but in point of fact, they hope to be able to get him to say publicly that he's Messiah so that they can go to Pilate and say, you got trouble here. You got a rabble rouser, and he's claiming to be king, and this is Rome, and it's Passover, and there's only one king. His name is Caesar. You better do something about it. But Jesus is so clever. He answers them with a question. Now, let me just, because I'm on the story, let me stop just long enough to, I want to talk for just arguing is like. Folks, today and forever, I mean, for ages and ages, If you want to study the law as a serious Jew, or more importantly, if you want to prepare yourself as a rabbi, a professional law teacher, you go to a school called a yeshiva, Y-E-S-H-I-V-A, yeshiva. And I always kind of wanted to get yeshiva. And so for years, I asked around and so on. I was frustrated. And finally, I was on a trip and I had a group, and this guide said, no, I know where I can get you into an Orthodox yeshiva, but you really don't go into the yeshiva. You go into a loft, but you're up there. You can see there's glass, but you can hear what's going on. And so they don't mind if you watch from up there. You just can't go in the yeshiva. So we did. And there we stood. And when we looked down on the yeshiva, it was a room full of two-sided desks. That is podium, stand-up desk. And there was a young man on either side, sometimes not all that young. And that is people of every age. They were arguing and gesticulating, and we could hear some of the rumble and so on through the glass. And the guide said, now here's what happens. We don't really get lectures. We're not taught in that way. What happens is that in the morning, the rabbi, the chief rabbi comes in, the teacher, and he posits a very, very difficult, thorny question out of the Torah. For instance, he said, the Moses said that if you have an ox and he gets loose and rips up your neighbor's garden, you got to pay for the garden. Well, what about if you have an ox and you went down and you bought a good stout rope from the local hardware store and you tethered him well and the rope broke and he ripped up the neighbor's garden? Who has to pay? And the one man is one of the two young men is saying, all right, you argue, you defend the owner of the ox, and the other one, you defend the guy who sold the rope. And that's what they're doing. And they're going back and forth, and they got the Talmud and they're looking for precedent, and they're, you know, arguing over this and that, and it's carrying on. And then he said, after a couple of hours, perhaps, and the rabbi just walks around and listens, and maybe corrects or instructs, but he just listens. And then after maybe a little while, then the rabbi calls the attention, and he says, now switch sides. So you argue for the guy with the ox, and you guy argue for the guy who sold the rope. And now they got to go at it from the other. And it really, that's how you train. By the way, in the middle of my, by the way, this is how Paul trained Saul. And he was to anticipate your opponent's argument. So if Paul says that where sin did abound, grace much more abound, he can hear his arguer, his opponent saying, well, then let's sin so that grace may abound. God forbid. Remember that in Romans. So the point is that Jesus is every bit playing by the rules. And so, and the idea, and let me tell you this. How does a man prove his manliness? How do you prove yourself a man among men? Arm wrestle. This culture, in Jewish culture, you know, among men, you silence your enemy in open debate. And so this is heavyweight pugilism. This is a championship bout. And again, I'm going to go back to it. The Sadducees and the elders, they come and they say, by what authority do you do these things? And Jesus knows what they're hoping for. They're hoping he'll say, I'm your Messiah. Then they'll have him. They can accuse him before Pilate. That's how they feel. We'll come back to that. Let me ask you a question. The baptism of John, was it of heaven? It's entirely orthogonal. Where did that come? Orthogonal, it is right angle. It seemed non sequitur. It's not. It's genius. Because the Bible says that they reasoned among themselves and they said, oh my goodness, if we say that John's baptism was from heaven, then we will have acknowledged Jesus as Messiah because John announced him as Messiah. And if John really came from God, then in point of fact, Jesus, this Nazarene, has every right to the temple. We can't say that. If we say that John's baptism was not from heaven, not of God, these people will kill us. This is how tense it is, because they love John the Baptist. Now, there's a huge crowd hanging on every word. And so you'll see here in verse 27, so they answered Jesus and said, we do not know. Now you need to understand that the place would have erupted. There would have been cheers and catcalls and huzzas, and the place would have erupted. Oh my goodness, one blow. and these people had admitted defeat. Now, after this, Jesus begins to speak parables, and Matthew lists all three of them. There are three parables. First of all, there's a parable of the two sons. A man had two sons. One of them said he wouldn't go, but then he went. The other said he would go, but then he didn't go. Which of the two did the will of his father? That's not a hard question. And of course, he draws him in. Don't you suppose Jesus was a really good teacher? And so they're listening. And so, well, the first. And then Jesus' application here is, I say to you that the kingdom of God before you. Now, I've heard this parable put, and only, this is the only telling. Matthew is the only one that actually records this particular parable. And I've heard it used as a defense of replacement theology, for instance, as if it's the Gentiles who come in. He doesn't mention what he is saying. I think there is something of that later on, but what he is saying, not of replacement theology, but of when he talks about in the marriage, in the parable of the marriage feast and sending the messengers out to the highways and byways. Yes. That these Jewish leaders are so convinced that they are going to enter the kingdom, and they're so contemptuous of the common man and of tax collectors and so on. But in point of fact, what does God demand? He demands repentance. And so these proud leaders had said they would enter the kingdom, but they're not going to. They haven't done the will of the Father. So, but people for whom they have contempt and people who have no standing in the religion and so on, they're the ones who, because of their repentance, are going to enter the kingdom. And then he tells the parable of the landowner, such a powerful parable about a man who had a vineyard. And as was the custom in that day, he let it out to husbandmen. And of course, when the fruit came, a portion of the fruit belonged to the owner. And so he sent messengers, he sent servants. But those vineyard keepers beat the servants. And so the man sent more servants, even more important servants, but they beat them too. And then the man says, and this is curious because generally parables are a little slice of life, but there is something about this which is unworldly. That is, who would do this? The owner sent his son. And if you compare the other tellings of this, it's his son, his only son, his well-beloved son. And they thought, surely he'll respect my son. They will respect. But when the vine dressers saw the son, let me take you to this. It's important in Jesus' parable. It's just a parable, but he's making a point. Now, when the vine dressers saw the son, they said among themselves, this is what they didn't say. They didn't say, this man claims to be the son, but we think he's an imposter. Let's kill him. That's not what they said. They said, this is the heir. Let us kill him and seize his inheritance. Do you not hear echoes of Caiaphas in John chapter 11, just those several weeks earlier? When it was reported that Jesus does many signs, that is reported, lest they come and take away our place and our nation. But Jesus becomes, and actually, as you read it in Luke, it says that he asked the people, what do you think that Jesus, I'm sorry, what do you think the vine dresser, I can scroll down to it here. It says, no, that's where they said, okay, I'm going to try one more time. Excuse me, but I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done this, but I said it. Now I want to find it. Here's the parable of the vineyard owner. And here's where he asked. This is what I'm looking for. Therefore, what will the owner of the vineyard do? Now, if you go to Matthew, it's clear that Jesus told him exactly what you can imagine. He tells this story and people are horrified. I can't believe that. And he says, what do you think the vineyard owner ought to do? And they say, well, they ought to take those men and cast them out and give the vineyard to someone who will bring forth the fruits. And then Jesus repeats it. And he says, here's where the people say it in Matthew. He will destroy those. In the other gospels, we learn that Jesus then repeated it. And he said, you're right. That's exactly what the vineyard, and then he went on to press it home and say, that's exactly what's gonna happen. And that is, he said, have you not read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected, back to Psalm 118, and these people have rejected, but that is gonna become the chief cornerstone or the head of the corner. But then he says this, and this is a chilling statement, that the kingdom of God will be taken from you and given to a nation bearing the fruits of it. I'm going to stop and say quickly, I know that this verse is often, I think, misunderstood to suggest that the nation there to whom it's going to be given is the church, or that this is replacement theology. The church is not a nation. And all throughout the Old Testament, the promise is that there is a generation of Jews which are going to believe that God is going to bring them to himself. They're going to repent, and they're going to receive the kingdom. And so the point is that that generation right there rejected it, and the kingdom is going to be taken from them and given to a later generation, a later nation. But everything in the Bible screams that that's a nation of Jews. It can't be otherwise. God can't unsay what he's already said. And there's nothing about this to suggest that he means anything other than another nation of Jews, another generation of Jews. So Jesus promises that, or he announces that by reason of rejection, this generation is not going to receive the kingdom that he had come to offer. And again, when the chief priests and Pharisees heard this parable, they perceived that he was speaking of them. But they tried to lay hands on him, and they feared the multitude. We read this before. So you have the parable of the two sons. And then you have the parable of the man with the vineyard. And then, of course, the familiar parable of the marriage feast. And all the people refused to come. And so, byways. And it's interesting that he also mentions that there was somebody who came in a drab garment. So he was tossed out. You can't do that. You have to make appropriate preparation for this kingdom, which is yet to come. So I think he is saying here that by reason of Israel's rejection, there's going to be a season when the gospel is going to the highways and byways. And he's anticipating the age in which we live. But a lot more to say about that, but I'll not take the time at this juncture. But oh, so here it is. It's Tuesday. First of all, he comes into the city and he's confronted by his enemies who say, tell us by what authority. He answers parables. And now, once again, he is confronted, this time by the Pharisees. And they had gone off and plotted. And they thought, what can we ask him? And they came up with this question. So they send their disciples. Notice what it says. They sent to him with the Herodians. Now, the Herodians are a bit of a mystery. They don't come up much, but everybody would allow that whoever they were supporters of the Roman government. And the Roman government there in Israel. And in point of fact, the Pharisees did all they could to resist the Roman government. So again, these are absolute enemies, and yet they come together because, you see, you could start a fist fight, I like to say, on virtually any street corner in Jerusalem by asking, do you think we should pay taxes to Caesar? Should we willingly, happily pay, or should we push back against that? And the Pharisees push back against it. The Herodians support it. So now they come and they ask Jesus, is it lawful? It's the Caesar, and they figure no matter what he says, he's going to have half this crowd, because on the one hand, they're trying to catch him in his word so that they can accuse him before Pilate. On the other hand, they're just trying to, as I say, derail this Jesus Express and get part of this crowd at least to begin to question Jesus. And so Jesus answers magisterially, take out a coin, look, an image of Caesar, an image of, on one side is the image of Caesar's, and he simply says the other probably had something to do with Israel, whether some branches and so on. But the point is, he says, you who resist paying taxes, you carry that coin. And so you acknowledge you render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. Render to God the things that are God's. And again, I love what Matthew says. When they, the leaders who had challenged him and heard these words, they marveled. It was so clever. They realized they'd been snookered. They'd been duped. They'd been bested. And so they left him and went their way. And now the Sadducees come, and this is the final confrontation. And of course, the Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection. Now, really, the Sadducees were thoroughly Hellenized, Grecianized, Platonized. That there was some grand nirvana, some grand cosmic consciousness in which we're going to leave our bodies because material is wicked, the physical is wicked, and we're going to absorb into some eternal spirit. They absolutely of a physical resurrection. And now here's a curious thing, real quickly. The Sadducees gave lip service to the Pentateuch. That is, they rejected all of the what we think of as the Hebrew Scriptures, all of the Old Testament, but they gave lip service and said they embraced the Pentateuch simply because one of the books in the Pentateuch is in fact Leviticus, and it's Leviticus that insists that you go to the temple and pay your tithes, and they simply knew where their bread was buttered. They, of course, lived on those tithes, but they really didn't believe anything. But I think very possibly Jesus decided to play by their rules. To prove the resurrection from the Old Testament, that's not hard. You go to Job, go to Daniel, go to Isaiah. There are a lot of the prophets. If you ask me to prove the resurrection of the body from the Pentateuch, the books of Moses, that would be more difficult. And I think Jesus maybe decides to play by their rules. And so he goes to Exodus chapter 3, the burning bush, and he reminds them that at the burning bush, Yahweh said, I am the God. And by the way, I am the God. The whole argument turns upon the tense of the verb. Jesus believed in absolute verbal plenary inspiration that the Bible is inerrant in all of its parts. Builds an argument just on the tense of a verb. But he says, God said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And then he said, you know that God is not a God of the dead, but of the living. So even though they are dead, they are still alive. That is, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob have been dead for 400 to 600 years. But Jesus proves that they live on. And again, the multitudes heard this and they were astonished at his teaching. So again, I think the drama we've just kind of walked through very, very quickly probably took most of the day and well into the day. But now, after all of those acrimonious and deliberate attempts to catch Jesus in the word, there is another question. And let me take you back to the passage. And it's a question by a young lawyer. And I like Mark's telling of this. It's a little longer. So let me take you to Mark. And here is his telling of this, because it says, one of the scribes came. Now in Matthew, he's called a lawyer. But the point is, he's clearly a young man who is preparing. He's studying. So a lawyer in the sense that he's studying the law. He's a yeshiva student. And he lives there in Jerusalem. I'll come back to that. But notice what it says. Having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that Jesus answered so well, he asked him another question. Now, Matthew says he asked him a question testing him. But I don't know that there was quite the anger or acrimony in this test. You know, one of the ways we're told, and I've read this in a couple different places, that you could give your rabbi, your teacher of the Mosaic Law, an opportunity to sort of spread his tail feathers, if you know what I mean, to sort of demonstrate his acumen. You would say to him, Rabbi, excuse me, I sneezed, I'm alone in the room. But you would say to the rabbi, Rabbi, explain the Ten Commandments on one leg. So while you're standing on one leg, and I think that's kind of what he is doing. He's saying, Jesus, Master, what's the greatest commandment? And of course, Jesus has this wonderful answer out of Deuteronomy 6, love the Lord your God. And then the second is like unto it, love the neighbors, and there is no greater commandment. And it's interesting that the scribe is kind of blown away, this young man. And he says, well said, teacher, I'm here. Well said, teacher. Then he went on to say, you have spoken the truth. There is one God, there is none other but he. And to love him with all the heart and with all the understanding, with all the soul, with all the strength, to love one's neighbor as oneself is more than the whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. So he kind of picks up on Jesus and expands. That's more important than all of the Levitical sacrifices. And Jesus' response is so instructive. He says, now when Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, you are not far from the kingdom of God. Now, there are two points I'd like to make here in passing. Number one is this, that it's so instructive and deliberately instructive that the gospel gives us this counterpoint. That is, Matthew, having told us about the angry and acrimonious and accusatory, or at least there was hoping to accuse Jesus, of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the elders and so on, he tells about this young man. And he is testing him, I think, more in the way that you would test your rabbi, expecting that he could use the opportunity to show himself well, but whatever it was, there's a different spirit here. I respond so enthusiastically. And I think it's just, it's a good counterpoint. It's a good balance because, as I say, there is such tension in the air, but there are those, even in the Pharisaic, or at least the community of those who are students of the law, there are those who really are open to the possibility that this might be the Messiah. Maybe I'm reading a little too much into it, but it's just a very, very different spirit. Now, the other point to be made here is, and this is totally conjectural, but I think it's kind of fun. There have been different guesses as to who this might have been, and the prevailing one, and the one that I think is entertaining, if not, we can't be confident, but I wonder if this is not a young rabbinical student who is studying actually under Gamaliel, and we know is living in Jerusalem with his sister probably, and he's from Tarsus. His name is Saul. And I just wonder if this might not be young Saul of Tarsus. Later on, when Saul encounters Jesus on the road to Damascus, Jesus says, it's hard for you to kick against the ox goads. And I wonder if this isn't an ox goad moment. Saul lived there in town. He was studying. He had sought Jesus, maybe not personally, but he had been attended upon Jesus' teachings and so on, and knew people who had been healed. So I don't know. I think this may be one of those ox goad moments. But I'm going to leave that, and let me take you to the next important event, and it's huge. It's and that is when Jesus challenges the leaders. And I want to go back to Matthew and his telling of this. So here we are in. Oh, I know what I did. Go back to Matthew, and here it is right here. Well, picture, you've had this little more pleasant interaction between Jesus and the young law student, but the Pharisees are still at it. And so now Jesus asks them a question. This is playing by the rules. So you're going to ask me, I'm going to ask. And so as they're gathered together, and I picture them with their heads together, you know, trying to come up with something, what are we going to do? And Jesus says, wait a minute, let me ask you, what do you think about the Messiah, whoever he is? What do you think about him? Whose son is he? And of course they respond, well, he's the son of David. That's the covenant, 2 Samuel 7, Psalm 89. And then he said this, how then does David in the spirit call his Messiah Lord? Saying, and now he cites Psalm 110. Psalm 110 is the Old Testament, any other in the New Testament. It's put to many uses. But on a couple of occasions, it's put to this use specifically. Peter's going to do this same, make this same argument out of Psalm 110. How does David, if Messiah is the son of David, call him Lord in Psalm 110? The Lord, Yahweh, said to my Lord, Adonai, sit on my right hand. Everybody acknowledges that this is a messianic psalm, and that it is Messiah who is being invited to share the throne of Yahweh. And so again, if David calls him Lord, how is he his son? Now, the point to be made and the point that Jesus is making and can't be missed is that yes, Messiah is the son of David, but he's more than the son of David because David calls him Lord. And therefore, this one Messiah, Jesus of Nazareth, the God-man, is at once the son of David, Romans 1:3, according to the flesh, he was of the seed of David, but by the same token, he is the son of God. He is one with God. Romans 1:4, he was declared to be the son of God by the resurrection from the dead. He was declared with power to be the son of God. So the point is, Jesus takes the initiative, he takes the offense, and he proves he legitimizes his claim to be Messiah. Yes, to be the son of David, but also the son of God. That is, David was the king. He would not swear allegiance to anyone but to God. And when he says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand, when David says that, my Lord there, the antecedent, if you don't mind, conceptually, is David. And because he's the author of the psalm. All right, so Jesus has aggressively defended his messiahship, his messianic identity. Now, I want to turn to a couple more, but very importantly, after this, as far as just, this is just kind of a rough outline or sequence of the events. The next event is here where Jesus pronounces woes upon the scribes and Pharisees. Now, this is kind of where I've been headed, and I'm well into the lesson, and I know it's gotten a little long, but I'm going to ask you to bear with me for just a moment, because in order to understand what's at stake here, and let me say I've come to the point where I want to answer the question, given Sunday, why Friday? And I have said that the answer to that question, I think, is Monday and Tuesday. But to appreciate that, you have to appreciate a dynamic of Jesus' life, which is so terribly overlooked. And I'm going to take the point. Let me take you to a document which you have available to you. I'm going to share the screen and go here. I think I have it up. All right, I may not have it here, but I'll find it. But let me say as I do that the, it is right here, right? All right, so this is the document I need, and I call it 10 Important Insights. All right, now, come back to me. The point is simply this. There is a dynamic, a strategy oft employed by Jesus, which absolutely, it's explicit in the narrative. And he is going to employ that strategy right here. Explain it to you, and I've tried to articulate it here on this list of 10 important insights. And wait a minute, I don't think I'm sharing. Hold on. I need to go back here and share. Sometimes I get strung out. It is right here. All right, so now this is the chart. And by the way, let me mention one other thing. This is one of the documents which I have uploaded to a Dropbox file. And I have encouraged people to go, and there are some resources there that I think might be a help to you. And then as we do these recordings, I'm trying to upload those as well. Today's didn't come out so well, so I'm redoing it. And this is the one I think that'll be in the Dropbox, I trust. But the point is that in order to get to the Dropbox, you have to have a link. And I put that link on the Facebook thinking that anybody could get to it. But turns out I was wrong. You have to have a Facebook account to access my Facebook page, and many of you don't. So this is what I've done. If you will go to my website, now I'm a little embarrassed about this, but I take trips to Israel. And so I'm not trying to advertise those, but I got to have some website you can easily get to. And from that website, you can, on that website, you can find the link. You need the electronic link to get to that Dropbox. That making sense to you? My website is called, and I did make this up, my son did, Doug Bookman Ministries. All one, Doug Bookman Ministries. Now, that makes it sound like I've got some vast ministry empire. That website is Doug Bookman Ministry. That's all there is to it, okay? But we invented it so that people could find out about the trips to Israel. If you go to that website, on the opening page, there's a link, and it says links. And if you go and just hit links, it'll take you. I checked just a little while ago, and a friend of mine, Hal Hunter Hayes, his dad's name is Hal. He's an old friend of mine. But anyway, Hunter Hayes just put this up, and so if you'll go to Doug Bookman Ministries, hit links, go down, you'll be able to find the link to that Dropbox and that folder. And in that folder, you'll find a number of resources. And I'd encourage you to at least to explore the HBRs. They can be a help to you. That's where I went to find it. So I'm back. So folks, stay with me. What I'm saying is that there is a strategy that we desperately need to understand. And it's all over the Gospels. But I say it here under number 6, that throughout his ministry, Jesus employed a remarkable strategy to unmask the superficial and hypocritical nature of the public adulation paid him by the multitudes. In other words, everywhere he went, he had huge crowds. He was the best show in town. He was fascinating. He was healing people. And it was and sometimes people would individually or smaller groups would come, and they would, it would seem that they were willing to follow him because they responded positively to his miracles. And yet Jesus knew that in many cases it was shallow and false. Strategy to test the genuineness of what seemed to be a willingness to follow him. And very simply, when confronted by what turned out to be shallow proffers, if you don't mind, of acceptance, he would speak hard words. And I don't mean words that were hard to understand. I mean words that were going to cost you something if you bowed the knee to them. They were hard to obey. And to take it a little further, and I have it there, when it was large groups of people, Jesus had built in there, there was built into the culture and the religious structure that day, a remarkable foil, a backdrop to which he could contrast himself. And he could say, not that, but me. And that backdrop, that foil, was the Pharisees. Because as I mentioned to you before, the Pharisees were universally they were thought to be certainly bound for the kingdom, and their commitment to the law and so on, if you supported them and so on, you would be dragged into the kingdom, perhaps on their coattails. So they were revered, and beyond that, they were feared because they could put you out of the synagogue. And it's for that reason that they were the perfect foil for Jesus. And so now he is able to say, if you're going to have me, you're going to have to reject them. And because it was both stunning cost, it was the perfect way to sort that out. Now, I want to take you to a couple of scriptures where this happens, and I'm going to go quickly, and I'm not going to go to the scriptures just for the sake of time, and I'm going to trust you to let me tell you the story. In John chapter 6, when Jesus feeds the 5,000, the next day he speaks hard words in the synagogue in Capernaum, and that same crowd, after he speaks the hard words were, you have to trust me as your spiritual bread as thoroughly and exclusively and entirely as the Israel in the wilderness trusted the physical. The bread that fell out of heaven was their only hope. It was physical bread. They ate it. Later on, they died, but they were kept alive by the physical bread. I am the spiritual bread that comes from heaven. Unless you trust me to that degree, you're doomed. And John 6:66 says, after this, his disciples went back and followed him no more. Again, the rich young ruler, do you get into heaven, or do you get into the kingdom more properly by selling everything you have? Of course not. But Jesus, this man, comes to him. He wants to swear allegiance, and he asks Jesus, how do I get into the kingdom? Do the law. Oh, I've done all of that. Jesus knows better. But he puts his, and I like to say, he knows how to put his finger on the most sensitive spiritual nerve in your body, in your spiritual body. And he says, well, go sell everything. Now, that's not how you get to heaven. That's not the point at all. But Jesus is testing what seemed to be a willingness on the part of this young man to follow him. The big one is the Sermon on the Mount. And it is so parallel to where we're headed that I need to spend a minute with it. The Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5-7, so basic. And by the way, it's important to what I'm saying here that the reason Matthew parks that remarkable 3-chapter sermon at the very beginning of his telling of the Galilean ministry is because he wants us to understand that that's how Jesus taught and presented himself again and again throughout the ministry. And it's interesting. The Sermon on the Mount, I always say that everybody who studies the Sermon on the Mount thinks he understands it better than anybody else, and I'm probably no exception. Forgive me here. But the fact is, I hear all sorts of discussions of the Sermon on the Mount. It's theologically what it means to the church and so on. You've got to ask yourself, first of all, what was Jesus saying to that crowd on that afternoon? What was he saying to that crowd? And you remember that these were people that gathered at Capernaum. You see, Jesus made his home Capernaum. He lived in Nazareth until he was about 30, but then he moved to Capernaum, did it very strategically. And so there were people bringing their sick from lands all around. And if you were going to bring your ailing child, where are you going to go? Jesus is out on a preaching tour. You're not going to be able to find him. You go to Capernaum and you wait. And so again and again, when Jesus would return to his home there in Capernaum, there'd be massive crowds of people waiting, hoping to be healed. And so he begins, and there's a season of healing, and his heart is heavy because these are people who have rejected him as their shepherd. And so now he goes up on a hillside. It's not a mountain, it's a hillside. I think I can take you to that hillside. It's a concave hillside that produces a sounding board effect if you stand partway up the hillside. He calls his disciples and ranges them at his feet because that's his rabbinical union card, and he begins to teach. He's teaching the masses. Now, I know it says he began to teach the disciples in Matthew 5, but at the end of Matthew 7, it says explicitly that the multitude was amazed because he taught them as one having authority. The disciples are his, like I say, his rabbinical calling card. So now you're down here. There are people down, tens of thousands, probably people, many of them, some of them with crutches that they'd thrown away, some of them seeing where they'd been blind and so on. And they see Jesus mount up and get up on that hillside, not at the top of the hill, but on the side of the hill where it'll produce a sounding board effect. And they'll say, hey, hey, hey. And then all the disciples come and sit and they'll say, hey, shh, shh, shh. The rabbi's going to teach. That's what's going on. He is calling the class to order. And now he begins to teach. And I like to say that you got all those people spread out, but somewhere in the on the side of the crowd, I want you to picture, if you will, a little gaggle of men. Their garments are deeper blue and their fringe is longer and their turbans are more spectacular and higher than anybody else. And they are the Pharisees. And you can see them a mile away. And they were mad going in, but they're going to be madder in a minute because Jesus, as he begins to speak, he gives a bit of an introduction and so on, but here is his key verse. He looks out, and I always say, picture him pointing. Picture him pointing at the Pharisees and saying to the crowd, unless your righteousness exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll never see the kingdom of God. Folks, a gasp would have gone up. And they'd have thought, what? These are the gatekeepers. They tell us that they're the ones who get to decide who else goes. You're saying they're not going into the kingdom? And now throughout the rest of the sermon, Jesus again and again, they say unto you, again, picture him pointing, but I say unto you, you have heard it said of old. I know some people make that a reference to the Old Testament. It is not. That phrase is never used of the Old Testament. It's always used of those who teach the Old Testament in the rabbinical writing. You have heard it said by them, but I say unto you, they say, I say. And then Jesus comes to the end of the sermon and he gives an invitation. And this is invitation. I think once again, pointing at the Pharisees, he says, there's a broad way and you can go in. It's a broad gate and many go in there. They're in and it goes straight to destruction. Or perhaps pointing at himself, or there's a narrow way. You can build your house on the sand. Once again, the Pharisees, or you can build your house on a rock. So what is Jesus doing in the Sermon on the Mount? He is saying, you can't have the Pharisees. You can't cling to the Pharisees' hope of self-righteousness and accept me as your king. Now we go back to Matthew 23, if you don't mind, with that as a backdrop. Because late on the day, on Thursday, Jesus, right here, chapter 23, and this is his last public discourse. And I want you to imagine all of these crowds. And you know what? Some of them had probably gotten a little bit disturbed of late in the course of the day, because yesterday he tossed off the Sadducees and the money changers. Fine, those are a bunch of crooks. But now he's begun to go after our Pharisees. And we're pretty close to the Pharisees. And we've worked hard to develop a relationship. And we're kind of dependent upon him a little bit to get us into the kingdom. And he starts beating up on the Pharisees. But now he turns the howitzer on the Pharisees. And he begins to say, he spoke to the multitudes, see it there, and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees. Now, let me just make a connection here. In Matthew 5, verse 20, that's the phrase he used. Unless your righteousness exceed that of the scribes and Pharisees, you'll never see the kingdom. Now, again and again, the scribes and the Pharisees don't, he says here, he says, don't do according to their works, because they say and do not do. They're hypocrites. And watch this. Woe unto you. This word woe is in the Old Testament most often used of a curse. It's part of a curse on some Gentile nation, which has defied God and his people, and they're going to be destroyed. And for him to pronounce these woes upon the scribes and the Pharisees, you can't imagine anything more dramatic. And he does it again and again. Now, both Mark and Luke reference this, but Matthew spells out the whole thing. And he says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. Wait, we're the ones who get you in. No. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you devour widows' houses. I love this in verse 15. Listen to this. Just imagine you're there, be in the moment, and you stand there in stunned silence as Jesus stands there and points at those Pharisees and says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you hypocrites. And then he says this, you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, and when he is won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourselves. You know what? There were a lot of people in that crowd that day who would have insisted they were disciples of those Pharisees. And they'd just been told that they, along with the Pharisees, that they're trusting in the Pharisaic message, are twofold more the child of hell than they might have been. Again, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. You pay tithes of your vegetable gardens, but you overlook the weightier matters of the law. And then he says this here in verse 24. And this would have been so startling. He says in verse 24, blind guides who strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. You know, I'm going to tell you something. That's hilarious. It is a hilarious picture. The Old Testament, the law says that bugs are unclean, so you can't eat bugs. But if they're microscopic, the rabbis says, if they're microscopic, then it's okay if you can't see them. But they would zealously, carefully take every leaf, every shred of the vegetables, and they would examine them, and they would look over them, and they would hand them to somebody else. Do you see any bugs? And so on. So they strain out a gnat, but these Pharisees were they were guilty of such crimes in so many different ways, and everybody knew it. And this picture of you strain out a gnat, but you swallow a camel is the perfect, hilarious caricature of these Pharisees. And I think the place probably, I think people were probably going, oh man. And again, can you imagine the anger of the Pharisees? But he doesn't stop. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees. You clean the outside of the cup. The inside is filthy. You're like whitewashed tombs. See, the issue here is this, that it's Passover, and Passover is a pilgrimage festival from everywhere, but maybe you're making a way across the countryside, and it's, you know, you want to rest for a little while, and you lean up against a rock somewhere, and somebody comes around the corner and says, I'm sorry, it's all overgrown with weeds and everything, but in point of fact, you're leaning up against Granddaddy's tomb there, and now you're unclean because you've touched a tomb, and now you can't go to Passover. And so the rabbis had decreed that at the feast seasons, all three feast seasons, everybody had to go out and slap a coat of lime over all of their tombs. Just take some lime and throw it on there so it was white and people would know better. And you know, the Mount of Olives is higher than the Temple Mount, and I wonder if Jesus is not sweeping his hand across the Mount of Olives and pointing them out, because it's always graves all over those that hill. You're like so many whitewashed tombs. You look good on the outside, you glimmer in the sun, people just brush up against you, and they become a stench in God's nostrils. That's what it is to be unclean in the Bible. The Hebrew mind just doesn't work well with the abstractions that we're so unfortunately comfortable with. And so to them, if you're unclean, you stink. You don't like having people around you that smell, and neither does God. So you have to be purified. You have to be cleansed. Well, you just brush up against those men, just brush up against you, and they become a stench in God's nostrils again and again. I got to be done. But notice how he concludes here. Serpents, brood of vipers. How can you escape the condemnation of hell? All right, folks, very quickly, what's going on here? I want to go back. Given Sunday, why Friday? The answer is Monday and Tuesday. And I've called them days of messianic proclamation. First of all, positive proclamation. As Jesus, in the most dramatic ways, using steps that could not be adequately, in other words, making a claim that would have been less adequately made if he just made it in words, by reason of his actions, cleansing the temple, the messenger of the covenant comes suddenly to his temple. And then by reason of taking control and demonstrating his superiority over all of his enemies and really vanquishing them in open combat, to where every one of them slinked away. I think that's the verb, slinked away. And until they weren't willing to ask any more questions at all. And now Jesus uses the scriptures to demonstrate his messianic identity. But then, after positively affirming so dramatically his identity and persona as Messiah, his authority as Messiah, now negatively, he puts distance between himself and the Pharisees. And so the question is, Why, given Sunday, why Friday? The answer is because on Tuesday, Monday and Tuesday as a whole, but especially here where it comes full, Jesus drove this city to a decision. Basically, what he is saying here, as he said in Matthew 5-7, you have an immediate precedent. He is saying, you choose. It was easy yesterday. Throw down your garment, all the excitement. We're sick of Rome. We know we can't deliver ourselves from Rome, so why don't we take him as our military king, our political king, our deliverer from Rome? But Jesus is saying, and he's using that same strategy, no, you're going to have to choose. If you're going to have me, you're going to accept me, first of all, Genesis 3, as your savior from the curse of sin. And you're going to have to abandon the self-righteousness, the law-keeping merit salvation of the Pharisees. That's what they taught. I know it's discussed, but that's what they taught. I would reduce it to this. And then one other point, and we'll be done. Number one, I would say, on Sunday, Jesus had ridden into the city and offered himself as Messiah, as deliverer first of all from sin, and then to the Jews, deliverer from their Gentile overlords. And that's exactly what the Old Testament promises. And Jesus is fully qualified. He's demonstrated that. To do that on Sunday, Jesus offered himself. That was the message. On Monday and Tuesday, the message of Monday and Tuesday is this. You don't take me on your terms. You take me on my terms. If the message of Sunday is, I offer myself to you as Messiah, the message of Monday and Tuesday is, you take me on my terms. And that means you reject the Pharisees' gospel of law-keeping in order to enter the kingdom. Now, it's Tuesday late afternoon. I think it's important that people are going to have a few days to go home. And I think that's why I say, I think they probably went home and individually or house by house or neighborhood by neighborhood, they sat around and thought, man, did you hear what he said about our Pharisees? You really want that kind of man? He's going to make that kind of demand of us that we reject the Pharisees? You know what that'll cost? So that percolates through the city, and they have about 3 days to think about it. And on Friday morning, very early, the news is going to get out like wildfire that this Nazarene is on trial before Pilate. And the city is going to wake up, and they're going to make their way out to the western side of the city, and Pilate is going to stand and say, I have a question. Who would you have me give you, Jesus or Barabbas? And at that moment, the city is going to announce the verdict. The verdict to which they have come, respecting Jesus' demand that they make a choice. They're going to say, give us Barabbas. So I'm going to say again, Monday and Tuesday, days of messianic proclamation, but they are so closely related to Sunday and Friday. Because on Sunday, they had welcomed him as king. What happened? What happened was Monday and Tuesday. All right, now, I'm going to leave that, and I meant to be talking to you at this time, but I want to go back to one other scripture, because there are three other issues that need to be addressed. I'm going to do it very quickly. As a matter of fact, here are those three issues that we've talked about. Here's where we are, and now Jesus, as he leaves the city, and I don't have on there that he encounters the widow who gives them her mites, and he's so blown away, I think, in contrast to the Pharisees. Comments on that. But then as he leaves the city, he weeps over the city. And then he makes his way out to Bethany, and along the way, he crosses. Disciples look back with wonder on the massive Herodian temple, and they say, oh my goodness, what marvelous buildings and stones. And of course, Jesus had already told them in Luke 19 on the way up to the city that not one stone was going to be left upon another. And so they ask him, when is that going to be? And Jesus gives a very important eschatological discourse where he makes the point that the tribulation will be the sign that the kingdom is soon to come. Now, we'll perhaps talk about that tomorrow. I don't want to take any more time tonight. or this afternoon. But let me say that the seventh item, so on the way back to Jerusalem, I'm sorry, the way back to Bethany, he preaches what we remember as the Olivet Discourse. But then he goes back to Bethany and they settle in for the night and Judas sneaks away. And we're going to talk about this tomorrow. Judas sneaks away to a hill south of Jerusalem where he finds the home, the personal home of Caiaphas, the high priest, not his priestly villa, that's up in the walled city on the western hill. But he makes his way out and there Caiaphas is gathered with other Sanhedrinists and Judas makes a bargain that enables them to lay a plot to arrest Jesus in connection with the Passover feast. That happens on Tuesday night, and we're going to talk about it tomorrow. And then there's one other event, and I've skipped over it, but I want to go back to it and conclude with this, and that is a lament over the city of Jerusalem. And let me take you back to that passage. Here in Matthew 23, and he's just pronounced those woes upon the Pharisees. And now he is making his way out of the temple and across the Kidron and up to the up on the Mount of Olives. He looks back, and for a second time, he weeps over the city of Jerusalem. I don't want to take, just give me 3 or 4 minutes here, because this is so important. Jesus, this is his lament. It's here in Matthew chapter 23 and verse 37 to 39. So let me read this for you, because I want you to see if this doesn't, if you don't hear an echo in your head. Jesus said, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. See, behold, your house is left to you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now, I think perhaps as I read that, you could hear the echo of another time when Jesus said exactly the same thing, and it's in Luke 13, and we made much of it. Let me take you there just quickly. I'm not going to read it, but it is word for word the same as what Jesus says here in Matthew 24. So much so that many have suggested that, well, it must have been said only once and somebody mislocated. Oh, no. It's part of the historical record. Luke 13, he's in Perea. It's several weeks before the Passover, and he is speaking it to some Pharisees who have come in the hopes that they might lure Jesus, trick Jesus back into Jerusalem. So he weeps over the city from afar several weeks ago in Perea. Now, he says exactly the same thing. He weeps the same lament in Jerusalem, that is outside on the Mount of Olives, on Tuesday, late on Tuesday. Why would he say the same thing twice? Well, here's the important detail. In Luke 13, he had said, and I'll go back there again, it's easy to do. He had said in the yellow, "You shall not see me until the time comes when you say, blessed is he who comes in the Lord." Now, I said that that's out of Psalm 118. And what Jesus was saying is, you're not going to see me until you welcome me as Messiah. And here's the point. I mentioned to you before that if you'd have been there that afternoon in Perea, Luke 13, you'd have said, you know what, that's not going to happen. But we traced the story. We actually were able to follow the biblical text to see the strategy that Jesus developed, the trip that he took, and the way he stopped in Bethany on Friday and sent everybody in and alerted the city. And in point of fact, it did happen. Jesus made it happen. He was clever enough to make it happen. And the city did cry out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now let me take you back to Matthew. The difference between these two passages is this. That promise in Luke 13 stands fulfilled. He said, "You're not going to see me until you welcome me as Messiah." They did welcome him as Messiah in what you and I remember as the triumphal entry. But here's a remarkable insight. This statement right here in Matthew 24, that is unfulfilled. That stands unfulfilled, but it's going to be fulfilled. It's going to be fulfilled when a white horse rider descends to the Mount of Olives and a generation of Jewish people who have been, who have been attacked by the Antichrist and who are brought to the end of themselves. And God sends a spirit of supplication, grace and supplication, I'm sorry. And they look upon the one whom once they pierced, and they look to him in faith, and they're going to cry out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It thrills my soul to realize this, that Jesus made the promise to his generation, and we'd have thought it's not going to happen. He was able to make it happen. Jesus made a later promise to that generation. And the generation that's going to receive that promise is yet to come. But I take it as Ebenezer, that just as Jesus was able to make it happen in his generation, he is able to make it happen again. And when he does descend and the city does cry out, "Blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord," it's going to be with genuine spirit-generated faith. And that generation, in fulfillment of God's covenant promise and to the glory of God, for no credit whatever to them any more than we can take credit for our salvation, but God keeps covenant. And there is a generation yet to come, which is going to be so shaped by God and so brought thoroughly to the end of themselves that they are going to look upon that descending white horse rider and they're going to cry out, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." I'm hungry for that day. I long for that day. Not just because a generation of Jewish people, I love the Jews, will come to faith, but because God will so powerfully put his covenant-keeping character on display. So Jesus laments over the city on Tuesday, and this is the last time he's leaving the city. The next time he'll come into the city, he'll go to the upper room, and he'll be to head for the upper room, and then, of course, he'll be arrested and hauled off to be crucified. We'll talk about that. Sunday, a day of messianic presentation. Monday and Tuesday, days of messianic proclamation, as he makes the truth so compellingly clear concerning himself, and then drives that city to a decision. It's me or the Pharisees. God bless you. We'll return to it tomorrow at 10 in the morning.